Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is April 13th, 2017. This is Maundy Thursday. This is a 7 p.m. service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Tomorrow is Good Friday. We have a service at 2 and 7. Sunday, Easter Sunday, there are services at 8 and 10:30. We have an Easter breakfast from 8:30 until 10.
Good evening, and welcome to our Maundy Thursday observance. We begin with the special liturgy for Maundy Thursday on page 258 in the front of your worship book. Also, we will be singing Psalm 116, as there is no insert, of course, so that means you want to go to page 338. That will take you to a page that says Psalm Tones, and then the next page is Psalm 1, I think, and 2. So you just keep turning the pages like you would in the Bible until you come to Psalm 116. So you may want to turn to that now and mark it with a ribbon, since it will be sung between the first and second reading. Also, you will notice the prayer of the day you do not have, so I will simply be doing the prayer of the day myself. And as we go along, you will notice some other differences in our liturgy for this observance of Maundy Thursday. So I ask that you turn to page 258 and invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. Friends in Christ, in this Lent season we have heard our Lord's call to struggle against sin, death, and the devil, all that keeps us from loving God and each other. This is a struggle to which we were called at baptism. Within the community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and giving the peace of reconciliation. On this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor and enter the celebration of the great 3 days, reconciled with God and with one another.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, source of all love, on the night of his betrayal, Jesus gave us a new commandment, to love one another as he loved us. Write this commandment in our hearts and give us the will to serve others as you were servant of all. Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God's word. Please make note that the gospel acclamation is on page 260, so you won't be able to turn back to that after the song.
Connie Singleton will be doing the readings.
first reading is from Exodus 12 chapter. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Special hymn.
Thank you. Our sermon text this evening takes us further along in the events of Jesus' last night on earth. We leave the upper room where we read in our gospel lesson that Jesus just given them a new command to love one another as he has loved us. And we go out of the upper room and cross the Kidron Valley into the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus has left eight of the disciples toward the front of the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's taken Peter, James, and John and gone deeper into the garden and asked them to watch as he goes and prays. Jesus goes and prays, and then he comes back to Peter, James, and John, and he finds them asleep. And he wakes them up and asks them, could you not watch with me 1 hour? And then he says to them, the verse that serves as our sermon text this evening, Matthew chapter 26, verse 41, watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Grace, mercy, and peace to God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. To watch, to be asked to stay awake, can oftentimes be quite a challenge. If you are not asked to stay awake, if you're not asked to watch, then oftentimes you find yourselves having a difficult time going to sleep, having a difficult time becoming comfortable. But let somebody say that magic word, watch, and suddenly your eyes become heavy, your head begins to nod off, and you fight to stay awake. Whether it is being on guard duty, supervising a youth group lock-in, driving a long distance on a trip, or keeping vigil by the bedside of a loved one, to watch can be an almost impossible task. To watch proves to be difficult for the disciples on this last night of Jesus' life. As I mentioned, he goes to the garden to pray and asks them to watch. And yet each time he goes and prays and comes back, he finds them asleep. As I already mentioned, they had left the upper room. In the upper room, Jesus had shocked his disciples by washing their feet, a custom that was reserved for the lowest slave of the household or the youngest child. Certainly was not done by one's teacher, one's rabbi, one's master. But Jesus does it to teach us that lesson of humility. And then while they're celebrating the Passover, Jesus does something different, taking some of the leftover bread and a cup of wine. He tells them that from now on, when they gather together, that bread will become his body and the wine will become his blood, and that this will be an assurance of the forgiveness of sins and the promise of everlasting life. He then gives them that new command to love. They sing a final hymn and they go to Gethsemane. And again, as I say, he leaves eight of the disciples in the outer garden, takes three, Peter, James, and John, deeper into the garden with him, telling them to stay and watch. He comes out, prays, or goes in, prays, comes back, finds them asleep, says, could you not watch with me 1 hour? Then says, again, our sermon text, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. Now, what seems to be an innocent request by Jesus is actually a statement packed with power as it echoes down through the ages to us today, celebrating or observing this Maundy Thursday. For as we gather today on this Maundy Thursday, Christians all over the world are doing the same thing. And as we gather, as they gather, Jesus is still giving us that command to watch and pray. For us as individual Christians, to watch and pray. For us as a congregation, to watch and pray. For us as a denomination of the Holy Catholic Church of Jesus Christ, telling us to watch and pray. So what do we have to watch for? What is Jesus warning us about? The first thing is telling us to watch against developing indifference. The word watch means to be vigilant. Vigilant, to be constantly on guard, constantly alert, constantly aware of what your responsibility is. It means to refrain from sleep. It means to give attention to God's revelation of salvation. So when Jesus is telling us to watch, he is telling his church, his congregations, his denominations, his individual followers, that we are to be vigilant in the practice of our faith, that we are to constantly watch for the attempts of evil to enter into the church and destroy the church, that we are to give attention to society and its attempts to destroy the church, and we are to be sharing with others the revelation God has made about himself through his Son, Jesus Christ. The disciples, with all that has happened so far that evening, seem strangely indifferent to Jesus' plight. On Sunday was a triumphal entry. Then came the cleansing of the temple. Then came disputes with the chief priests and the religious leaders. Now they've gathered together for Passover, and Jesus has done these different things that we already went over. Now he's telling them to be on guard, and they seem totally indifferent to it. They don't seem like they have any concern whatsoever. Even though Jesus told them in the upper room that one of them would betray him, that he would be handed over to evil men, that he would suffer and die, and on the third day rise. And yet it is as if he had never said a word. When we see the action to the disciples this evening. Instead of watching, instead of being vigilant, they are sleeping. They exhibit almost a total lack of concern for Jesus and his upcoming agony, his passion, his death, and then the glory of his resurrection. The message for congregations and denominations, and we as individuals, followers of Jesus Christ, is the same, that we must watch. We cannot fall asleep to the needs of the world. That we must watch, and we must be awake, and not allow indifference to take over us, so that we ignore the plight of the poor, the oppressed, the persecuted, the homeless, the widow, the orphan, the veteran, the stranger in our midst who is in need of some type of ministry. Instead of being vigilant, too often today the church becomes immersed in itself. It becomes immersed in what it wants. It becomes a place of personal agendas, and the worst of all, a place to try social engineering, which is no place in the Church of Jesus Christ. Today you hear people say, well, I'm born again. I'm saved. What do I need to worry about? Let the poor take care of the poor. I have more important fish to fry. And so instead of watching, we are indifferent. Some years ago, a pastor was elected to be the head of the denomination of which he was a part. He was a pastor of a very large congregation that had grown very impressively over the years he had been there. And as the reporters began to sniff around the reports of the congregation, the annual reports and so forth, they found that this congregation's so when this pastor was asked about it, he said, well, when you're busy growing, you gotta keep building new buildings. To which one reporter asked him, well, do you think in Jesus' mind, in Jesus' set of priorities, what do you think for him is more important, buildings or saving souls? What is more important? To have a building big enough for everybody to gather for one service, to sit in theater-type chairs that recline and have a cup holder for your latte or your frozen coffee or whatever? Or is it more important to be a little crowded, or maybe even to suffer through no air conditioning and be spending that money instead on supporting more missionaries and more evangelists to save more souls and bring more people into the kingdom of God? The church is to be outreaching, it is to be outward working, but too often in the latter part of the 20th century and in this first part of the 21st century, the church has become too often introverted, concerned only about itself, and maintaining the status quo. When the Russian Revolution took place, it was known as the October Revolution, the Tsar was deposed, and Lenin began setting up communism in Russia. One of the complaints about the Russian church was that it had become too complacent, that it had become too comfortable in the status quo, and that the church was not fighting for the serfs and the peasants and the poor, that the church was not bringing to the attention of the Tsar and to the attention of society the needs of the poor and the hungry and the widow and the orphan, the one needing to quench their thirst, to feed their hungry stomach, to be cured of their illness. And so this is why there was some anger toward the Russian church at the beginning of the Russian Revolution, because it had been seen as only caring about itself. It had become a church that had fallen asleep and had failed to watch. Just like the disciples tonight are sleeping instead of watching. As the church today continued to fail to watch, is the church today, are too many congregations today, are too many denominations today too concerned with themselves and the status quo to bring to society the needs and ills of the oppressed, the downtrodden, the persecuted, and the ignored? Remember the great judgment parable in Matthew 25, chapter just before our sermon text for tonight. Jesus tells that parable of the sheep and the goat, and the sheep are sent into paradise. Jesus tells them that they're there because they fed the hungry, and clothed the naked, and gave a drink to the thirsty, and visited the sick and in prison. And they asked when they did this, and he said, whenever you did it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you did it unto me. And then we had the goats. And the goats are subject to condemnation. And Jesus says, it's because I was hungry and you did not feed me. I was thirsty and you did not give me a cup of cool water. I was naked and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you did not visit me. And he said, Lord, when did we see you like this? We never saw you like that. And again, Jesus said, when you fail to do it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you failed to do it to me. So why were the goats condemned? Not because they didn't build enough buildings. Not because they didn't have air conditioning in their sanctuary so everybody could be comfortable in the hot days of summer. They were condemned for not doing ministry where it was needed. They failed to feed, to clothe, to give a drink of water, to visit, to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Does the church today need a wake-up call? As Jesus continues to wake up the disciples this evening, time and time again, and asking them to watch and pray, does the church need to hear that same message? Do we need to be more vigilant? Do we need to work harder at spreading the good news of the gospel? The church is to be a light for society. Remember in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said that we were to be like a city shining on a hill that could not be hid. That we were to be like a light shining in a darkened room. And when you have that light shining, you don't put a bushel basket over to go back into the darkness. The church is to be the light for society, just like our coastline is lined with lighthouses to guide ships and keep them from the dangers of the shoreline. The church is a lighthouse for society, guiding it through the rocky shallows of life and to keep it from sailing into the danger and destruction of sand, dunes, and shallow water. If the light goes out, then we're plunged into darkness. The second thing the church must do is that it must watch during times of temptation. The word temptation literally means to experience that which causes one to fall or fail. So in other words, the word temptation here, as Jesus uses it, means anything that causes us to fall or to fail in our efforts of being Christ into our day. Anything that causes us to fall or fail and spreading the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Anything that causes us to fall or fail so that we're not like the sheep, but end up like the goats. So the church must ever be ready against the onslaught of the devil who brings those temptations to make us fall and fail. The devil wants nothing more than for the church to be asleep. For if the church is asleep, all kind of anarchy can break out. If the church is asleep, then evil can make great gains. As we have seen in the history of the 20th century. The church fell asleep. And Nazism took over Germany. The church fell asleep. And communism took over Russia and most of Eastern Europe. The church fell asleep and allowed apartheid to become the way of life in what was Rhodesia in South Africa. And distracted, the church dozes off unaware of the evil that is advancing and fails to prevent evil intent as it uses church language to confuse people and fool people and to turn the church away from its mission. The mission of the church is to bring others into the kingdom of Jesus Christ. The mission of the church is to save souls, not to build glorious buildings to one's own ego or one's own memory. Make Christians of the world. When the church sleeps, it fails to prevent injustice, it prevails to prevent starvation, it fails to prevent oppression, it fails to prevent chaos and anger. Several years ago, our middle son, last night, landed safely back in Indianapolis after his 10 days of mission in Nepal. A couple years ago, he and I set up a date in which we met in Louisville to go and see the University of Louisville basketball game at the new arena. Of course, at that time, Mom was still in her house, so we spent the night at Mom's house. But to not have to deal with traffic and so forth, we took a taxi down to the arena and we took a taxi back. Well, when the game was over, the taxi that we took back, the driver, was a man from the African country of Malawi. And he had a very interesting biography. He told us how he was growing up as a kid in Malawi. It was a very terrible place. People cheated each other, people robbed each other. There was little justice. It was the old might makes right, strong to survive. He said, and then something happened. Missionaries came in with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he said, the gospel of Jesus Christ totally turned the society of Malawi upside down. He told our middle son and myself that we could go to Malawi and we wouldn't have to worry about a thing. We wouldn't have to worry about being mugged or kidnapped or any type of violence because Christianity had become the way of the country. That's what the church can do when it's awake. But when the church falls asleep, you miss out on such opportunities. Flesh is weak and powerless. But God gives us power through the Holy Spirit to help the church and gives the gift of prayer so that we can continually pray for the church and its mission. The church must keep watch at all times so that it may continue to do the will of Christ. And what is that will? Go therefore into all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. That is the will of Jesus Christ. That is why we must stay awake. That is why we must pray, so that we may continue to do the will of Christ. So let us watch, and let us pray. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing Go to Dark Gethsemane, hymn number 347, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 347.
Thank you.
pray for the church, the world, and any who are in need. Our response tonight is, hear our prayer. For the church, that living according to Jesus' new commandment and by his example, we may grow in our love for one another and all people. God of mercy, hear our prayer. For the leaders of nations, that their goal may be dignity and reconciliation for all, and that conflict and discord would give way to peace and unity throughout the world. God of mercy, hear our prayer. For all people in need, that they may receive your blessing, and that we may be led to care for our brothers and sisters who suffer hunger, illness, oppression, loneliness, abuse, or any physical or spiritual disease. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
For this congregation, that we would take up whatever cross is laid upon us and gladly carrying it, sharing in Christ's death that leads to his everlasting life. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for all the saints and martyrs who follow the example of the one who washed his disciples' feet and who now rest from their labors. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayers, gracious God, for the sake of the one who came to serve and not be served, and offered himself for the sake of the world, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift
thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant in my blood, shed here for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering therefore his sacred command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to the Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we're able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit, to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may come forward as you deserve. can, please stand. The body of the Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen and preserve you in true faith and a life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your suffering, death, and resurrection. May the sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the way we live. We live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Ask that you turn to Psalm 88 and just sing the psalm together as the altar is.
Thank you.
That concludes our service.